Well, good morning, everybody. Let's all stand to our feet. We're going to worship the Lord today. What a beautiful day out this morning, huh? No wind for a change. Everyone's eyes are burned from the wind. Mine are, being out in it all week. But no, it's been great, great weather. Thank you, Lord, for the great weather we have. Thank you, Lord, for the family of God that we can gather together corporately and worship you. Lord, come and flood this place with your presence. Fill this place in Jesus' name.
High. You be lifted higher. I belong to you. I am nothing.
Welcome the presence of Jesus in this place. Amen. He's all we need. Amen. Do you believe that?
What is this love that won't relent? Reaching wide to save our souls. Only you. What is this grace that makes no sense? That we could never recompense. Who gives us all a second chance? Only you.
Who spoke to form the universe? Only you.
one like you. No one like you, Jesus. No height or depth can stand between us, no power.
Ever be on my lips, ever be. Your kindness makes us whole. You shoulder our weakness, and your strength becomes our own. You're making me like you, clothing me in light, bringing beauty from ashes. For you will have your bride, free of all her guilt, and rid be on my lips. See you.
remain standing. Our nation is at a turning point. There is a lot going on, some of it good and some of it horrible. But we are at a turning point. The population is fed up with the direction, many of the population, with the direction that our leaders, some of our leaders, have taken our nation. It's almost bizarre, actually. I never would have believed years ago that I would see this happening in our nation, the way that the government has turned it. But our nation's on a turning point today. But listen, while we were singing, put those words up. Remember how our God has never failed us. Listen to me now. Psalm 72 verse 8 was declared over this nation at its foundation, that he shall have dominion from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. Joan and I went into national television because we had a vision for our nation. We believe that God has a destiny for our nation. And right now, the destiny of Canada is in warfare. It's in a struggle. And we're going to stand and agree this morning, and then we're going to sing this again, that we remember our God is faithful, that he can save our nation, that he can take Canada and put her in the place that she is destined to be, that she will be a nation for the healing of the nations, according to Revelation 22 verse 2. So join hands with the person next to you. We can do that now. Praise the Lord. We can join hands. And we're going to agree in prayer, and then we're going to do this again. Remember, we're going to remember that our God is faithful. Lord, we come together in agreement. We join hands as a sign of our agreement that we believe Canada will be saved. That Canada will be saved. That Canada will be saved. We declare a turning point in our land. We declare that Canada will be saved, and you will have dominion. You will have authority to rule in this nation from sea to sea, from the river to the ends of the earth. We pray that the glory of God will fill Canada as the waters that cover the sea. We declare that your word will go forth in our nation, and that the powers of the darkness and the powers of the enemy will be broken. They will be broken over our land. Amen. Let's declare it.
Remember how our God has saved.
Thank you, Lord, that this will be established. This is not a plan of man. This is your purpose, your desire, your vision for this nation. Oh, that Canada would be a vision of the glory of God upon the earth. That Canada would be an example of a nation redeemed from darkness. Today, Lord, we declare the shift over this land. We declare that your purpose is established and it will not be changed, and that your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. And all of God's people shouted, amen. Say amen. 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 Give him a shout. Amen. Yes, we give you a shout, Lord. We give you a shout. You can be seated. You can be seated. At Tefila, this past Wednesday, we had a powerful breakthrough in prayer. And it was just one of those, who knew why, but it just was one of those things. And Pastor Gord brought his iPhone, and it had the sound of the shofar, and he talked about Jericho and how they went around the walls in silence. But on the seventh time, on the seventh day, he played the shofar. They shouted, and the shofar blew, and the walls fell, and he played the shofar. And then we went into a time of prayer, and we began to just shout in the Spirit. And I believe something was fought in the spirit realm and won as we sensed it. And it's not just here, it's across our land. Our nation is at a turning point. And we are, Joan and I have carried this vision. We are our vision in opening Christian television in Canada and doing 24-hour Christian television in Canada was to change the spiritual climate of this nation. You know, our climate is known for being wintry, but we can change the spiritual climate. Amen. We can't turn it into palm trees, but we can change the spiritual climate, and it can be a landing place for the glory of God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Joan's going to come.
Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning. There's something new and fresh in this place this morning, isn't there? Can you feel it? God is good. Amen. Just before we bring our offerings to the Lord and worship Him with our offerings, I just want to mention that today is our pickup pie day. And so after the service, you can go, it's a women's ministry fundraiser, so we're charging $5 per slice of pie. But we can have coffee along with the pie. Isn't that wonderful? Little bit of restrictions being lifted, and so you can pick up your pie and either take it home with you and eat it there, or you can eat it here and have some fellowship with those that are in the service this morning. So God bless you as you do that. And also this morning, as we worship with our offering, I'm just so filled with anticipation of what God is about to do in this nation. We are at a tipping point. We are at a turning point, but you know what? The people of God keep marching forward, and the army of the Lord will prevail. Amen? So as we receive our offering this morning, the ways to give will be up on your screen. But I wanted to read out of Galatians today. Galatians 6, I want to read the two verses, verse 7 and then verse 9. It says, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, that will he also reap." And then in verse 9 it says, "And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart." Amen? We've been through a long 2 years, and it's really easy for us to lose heart, isn't it? But God says we will reap if we do not lose heart. Just a couple of notes that I wrote down here from this scripture. Number one is God has a due season for every seed we plant. You know, sometimes we plant a seed and we expect the harvest to come tomorrow. But when it doesn't come tomorrow, then we lose heart. But God says, no, there's a due season. So the due season for the seed that you plant today may be tomorrow. It may be a quick turnaround, but it also may take time to develop and for God to work and for God to bring the answer to you. So there is a due season. And the other thing is, there's always a harvest. It doesn't matter whether we plant good seeds, whether we plant bad seeds. It's just a kingdom principle. Whatever we sow, we're going to reap. If you sow love, you're going to reap love back. If you sow forgiveness, you're going to reap forgiveness back. If you sow finances, you're going to reap finances back. Amen? Because God is good, and he's a God of his word. And the other thing is this, God is seldom early, but he's never late. Amen? Amen? How many can agree with that? Sometimes I think, God, it's why do you always wait till 11:59? Right? Why do you always do that, God? Because he's testing your hearts. Are you going to lose heart? Are you going to believe? Are you going to stay firm? But he always, always brings the answer at the right time. So some things to do as we give this morning, refuse to become discouraged. Let's say that, God, I refuse to become discouraged. Because I know that God sits on the throne and everything is in his control. Do you know that he has control of your life today? He has you in the palm of his hand. And he controls everything when we put our hope in him. If we don't put our hope in him, then he can't control. That's why our hope needs to be in God. Amen. Keep your faith alive and active. Give and keep on giving. Love and keep on loving. Sow and keep on sowing. And then this morning, I was reading this yesterday and I thought, you know, according to this scripture, in verse 7, it says, whatever a man sows, that will he also reap. And I just decided today, and I think we can do this according to the word, name your seed today. I put it on my envelope. I'm not going to tell you what I named it, but I named it. And I'm believing for a harvest on this seed. This is not my tithe. It's an offering over and above my tithe. And I named it this morning. So what are you sowing today? Are you sowing for a family member? Are you going to name your seed for healing today? Are you going to name your seed for the nation today? For the nation to be saved? Whatever it is, let's just write it on our offering envelope if we have one. If not, write it on your heart and just say, God, as I sow today, I'm sowing for, well, I will just say this, I'm sowing for my sister's healing because we're believing for a miracle for her. Amen? So that's one of the things I'm sowing for. But I wrote some other things on my envelope too. Can we do that today? I really believe that God is a God of his word. And when we put our faith and when we put our trust in him, he always comes through. He always does. He's a good God. So, Father, as we give today, we come today to honor you and to worship you with our offering. But, Lord, according to your word today, that whatever a man sows, that will he also reap. We name our seed today. And, Father, we thank you that you're a good God and that you're a God of the harvest. And there's always a harvest for what we're believing for. We believe that, Father. We sow our seed in faith and with expectation because you're the God that never lies. You're a God of your word. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. God bless you this morning.
Well, the big day is finally here. The Third Day phone app is live and ready to go. Let's get you connected. Here's how. You can go to the Third Day Church website and click on Get the app. All you have to do is choose your phone, Apple or Google. If you want, you can also go to your app store and search for Third Day Church. Then select Get and wait for the app to download onto your device. You'll see the Third Day logo on your screen. Tap it to open. The first thing to do is to click Allow under the notifications message. This will ensure you get all the latest news and reminders. Now, click the three horizontal bars at the top left of your screen. In the menu that appears, click the Settings or Wheel icon. Then, click the Notifications tab. Then, click into Third Day Church. Depending on how you downloaded the app, this note may or may not appear.
Now you'll get a list of all the Third Day ministries. By simply moving the toggle button on the far right of the screen, you can activate or deactivate the ones you want by turning the toggle to green. Hit the back arrow to return to the home screen and get ready to explore the app. If you ever get lost, just hit the home button in the lower left-hand corner. Third Day is now at your fingertips. From Bible reading and devotionals, to video of Lifeline Today in our Sunday sermons, to what's happening, calendar, prayer requests, and even 3D radio. You can watch live streaming, donate online safely and securely, and find many ways to connect with others. Remember to share the app with others and check it daily.
I believe that we are seeing a shift in our nation. We'll see a shift spiritually. You know what? I want to make something clear. We may not return to the days of peace and tranquility, but we will return to the days where God will move in our nation and our nation will move in her destiny. And I think that is such a pivotal time that we're in right now. And you can sense it in the spirit. And even this morning in the prayer time and in our service, you could sense that. This morning as well, I want to just share a message. And then I have some things I'm going to announce about where we're going in the future. But my message is called Restoration. And as you know, I've been doing a series beginning in the beginning of January from Isaiah 58. Verses 11 and 12 that talks about restoration, some powerful promises. And we've looked at other scriptures throughout the Old and New Testament that deal on that subject and are related to that subject. Last week I talked about the open heaven, and an open heaven is a sign of restoring and the double blessing that God brings upon his people. So we're going to begin this morning again with Isaiah 58 and starting in verse 11. The Lord guide you continually and satisfy your soul in drought and strengthen your bones. You shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. Those from among you shall build the old waste places. You shall raise up foundations of many generations, and you shall be called the repairer of the breach and the restorer of the streets to dwell in. So many adjectives in these verses here. Satisfy your soul in drought. He will guide you continually. All these blessings. He will strengthen your bones, which is really a blessing. It's a blessing of your vitality, spiritually and physically. You will be like a watered garden, which is fruitful, and a spring of water, whose waters do not fail. All of these are adjectives that are profound. They say something very positive about your individual life, but also as a group or as a nation, because this was spoken to a nation through Isaiah. But notice this, there are adjectives here that are the outworking of all this blessing. And so let's put them up there. Four of these amazing adjectives. Build the old waste places. Raise up the foundations. Repair the breach and the restore of the streets to dwell in. Now, even the fact that you're using all these words, rebuild, restore, repair, suggests something. It suggests that there's always a time for rejuvenation, a time to renew. You know, when there's revival, things begin to move mightily. People become saved. People come to the Lord. It's profound. But then there's this process almost of unwinding of the blessings that God has poured out on his people. And so the day comes around where there needs to be restoration again. There needs to be a rejuvenation of what God has done. For those of us who have experienced not one, but maybe multiple revivals, and I have, I can think back to those days, and they are profound. And I've never lost my memory for those days. As a matter of fact, that becomes the threshold for me. I think of everything in terms of what we experienced in those days, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, the things that God was doing. I saw people being delivered, demons coming out of people, bodies being healed. And that becomes the threshold of what you see when you see God moving. And I believe we're on the cusp of seeing this again. In fact, I believe this is where God is going in this hour, restoring things that he has done. In fact, what I believe is that he's going to take, and I say this because of where we are in the timeline of man. and then timeline of God. I believe he's going to take every revival that we've seen through the history of the church, and he will combine it and pour it out in the last days. Now think of this. Every revival, some profound revivals, and he's going to pour them out, and every one of them had unique attributes, things that happened, things that were done, things that were restored. Every one of them were profound. But imagine if God took all of them and combined them in one. I believe that's what Romans 11, verses 11 and 12 are telling us. Talks about when Israel is saved and the Gentile church and the Jewish people come together as one. The description in verse 12 says, it will be like life from the dead. In other words, there will be something so profound that will be released on the earth that it'll transcend anything that our minds can recall or even think about. There are no biblical precedents for it. It'll be beyond that. He said, it will be life from the dead. That's a profound scripture, you know. I love that scripture. And it shows us that God has something so big in mind. And what we sensed in this last Wednesday in prayer and then today in the service again, we sense that God is doing something in our nation. Now listen, it's not just because you have people flying flags. That's the manifestation. God is doing something in the nation, changing and shifting the atmosphere. And that's producing a movement. And I believe that what we're seeing is the beginnings of a shift over our land. And the direction will shift. Now, if it doesn't, we're in deep trouble. We're in deep trouble. Well, the spiritually mature walk in a spirit of restoration. Do you know that? The spiritually mature are the ones that say, no, the present isn't good enough. We want to bring back what God has said he would do and what he has done. We want to see his mighty works again. We want to see him move. How many would agree with that? Amen? Amen? Yeah. I want to see Canada saved. Hallelujah. I always think of our good friend Charlie Robinson at times like this. Many years ago now, it's probably over 30 years ago, he had a visitation from the Lord. And he saw the throne room of God. And in the throne room of God, nation after nation came in. And as the nations came in before the... And how many know the Bible describes nations coming before the throne of God? We keep some identity somehow when we go into heaven. We keep some kind of identity there. And so he saw all these nations coming in. And of course, there was praise and glory going up. And then he heard these words. It was almost like the Olympics, right? Where there's this massive meeting and massive people and delegation after delegation is coming in. And finally he heard these words, loud and clear, Canada! Well, I don't want to shout it on my mic, but it was a shout. And the throne room and all of the nations went into an uproar. And as they went into an uproar, the delegation of Canada with its red and white flag, right, and the maple leaf came into the throne room. And there was this shout unto God because of what God had done in the nation of Canada. Amen. Now, I'll tell you why words like that really grip me, because all of our lives, Joan and I have been focused on this. We have had a calling to speak to our nation. This is why we've used media. We opened the media in Canada. Prior to 1993, you could not have a religious or a Christian broadcast licensed radio or television. We challenged that. Joan and I were the ones, and our church and all of those with us, we challenged that. I went up before the CRTC, had many hearings. It was just quite a process, actually. And then the nation changed. They changed the regulations, not perfectly, but enough so you could have Christian TV. And then we launched in the most unlikely place in Canada, Lethbridge, Alberta, to launch a national television network. But we did it here. It was the dumbest thing ever in the natural. But who's going to argue with God? And he did the miracle, and that's why it was called the Miracle Channel. And we began to speak forth words of destiny over nation. Do you know what I've heard prior to 2000 and prior to the early, late 1990s? People would say to me, I've never heard anybody talk about the destiny of Canada. I've never heard anybody say that Canada had a destiny. But now I'm believing it. I see it in the scriptures. There was only a handful. Bill Prankard was one, but there was only a handful of people that would go around and declare that Canada will be saved, and Canada has a destiny. And so this was our history. We got into doing that and shifting the nation. It was a work of restoration, but we began to declare what God wanted to do in our land and do with our nation. And I want you to know, the spiritually mature lay hold of that work. They say, we'll not let go until Canada is saved. So listen, we're living in a time of history in our nation where this shift has to happen, where we need to go in this direction, where God will restore the streets to dwell in Canada, where He will repair the breach. And what we need to do is walk in the spirit of restoration. I want to share this with you. It is absolutely profound. It's a quote from the Welsh Revival, and I think it says everything that we need right now. It is ever the darkest hour before the dawn. The nation always seems to be given over to the evil one before the coming of the Son of Man. The decay of religious faith, the deadness of the churches, the atheism of the well-to-do, the brutality of the masses, all these, when at their worst, herald the approach of revival. Things seem to get too bad to last. The reign of evil becomes intolerable. Then the soul of the nation awakes. This was 1904 in the Welsh Revival. The Welsh Revival was one of the more profound. It swept the region of Wales. Hundreds of thousands were swept into the kingdom. They were saying that this was a precursor to the Azusa Street outpouring in 1906. And it was Evans Roberts led it, an intercessor, led this great revival. And what happened is literally hundreds of thousands swept into the kingdom. And it says this. It says that the crime rate dropped to almost nil. And so the police force didn't know what to do. And you know what they did? They created choirs and quartets. And they said, where did the police go? Well, we go where the crowds are. Well, where are the crowds? Well, they're all in the churches. And we go and we sing. This is the police force. We go and we sing in the churches. Many of the songs that they still sing in the taverns of Wales are the old revival songs of 1904. They still are sung. You know what they say about the donkeys? They were, you know, Wales was known for coal mining, and they would take the animals, donkeys, to pull the trolleys of coal down deep in the mine. It says that when the Welsh revival began to move in its fullness, the donkeys became confused. And they didn't know how to work in the mines, and they didn't know how to go because they were so accustomed to the miners swearing at them and using coarse language that the donkeys, when the men got saved, would no longer swear. They didn't know what to do. They didn't understand their commands. And it took a time for the donkeys just to figure this out so they could pull the coal in the mines. This is recorded in history, folks. This is how a land has changed. And I'm going somewhere with this because I believe that we're at a time where we're repairing the breach. We're doing these things. We're building the old waste places. We're raising up the foundations. We are repairing the breach. We're restoring streets to dwell in. We're doing something to make a way, to make a highway for our God. Come on, I'd need a bigger amen than that. Listen, we're not going to be a passive people and get revival. Lord, send revival, but do it before 10 and 11 because I got to get out of here. That's just meant as humor, right? But you understand that God doesn't always work with our timeline. We need to be together. Now, listen, the spiritually mature work in agreement to advance the kingdom of God. Do you understand me? Spiritually mature people work in agreement. They don't divide, they agree. They pull together, they don't divide. And listen to me, when you see a spirit to divide, you know what's at work. They pull together, agree for the work that's ahead of them to bring the nation into fullness or to bring their nation or their city into fullness. I want to put up the prophet Amos, Amos 3:2. Can two walk together unless they are agreed? This is a principle of the kingdom. We come into agreement for a purpose. We come into an agreement because we know there's power in agreement. There's power when we do this. We release it on the earth. Matthew 18, 19 says this, "Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there in the midst of them." Now, I want to point something out to you. That's the minimum size crowd. One isn't a crowd. But he said, if two or three, anybody can make that threshold. And he said, if any two or three come together in agreement, he said, then they can move into the spiritual realm and ask what they will, and it will be done. There'll be a release of spiritual power, release of heaven's blessing. Wow. Do you like that? That's amazing, isn't it? I find this very, very encouraging. Let's look at some of the facts about agreement. The place of agreement is among the brethren. Look at that picture. Isn't that a great picture? We have a man up, men's prayer meeting here Saturday mornings at 8 a.m. It wasn't this Saturday, but it will be this coming again. And that's what we do. We agree. Sometimes it's not as dynamic as other times, but it's still men coming together. You know, what else? You know, they could be doing tons of other things on Saturday morning, but they come together to agree. Thank God for that. We need to be people of prayer. You know that? We do. We need to be people of prayer. You can get people out Sunday morning, but how about on Wednesday, a prayer night, prayer meeting? How about that? What about that? You see, we need to be people of prayer. Otherwise, you know what? We get off track. We need to be in prayer all the time so the Lord can keep putting us in the right place. He can kind of hit us on this side when we're going this way, or hit us on that side when we're going that way. So we get in the right way. That's what we need. It helps us. But it also helps us hear from the voice of God. I was so pleased with Wednesday because it really was spontaneous. Nobody planned it. Nobody. It was just one of those things that just went into one to the, and then Alyssa just had the right songs, and it just, boom, it just went. And there was, I was standing there, and we were just doing something in the Spirit, groaning and what, I don't even know, declaring, roaring. And you know, I thought to myself, I could do this for 24 hours. The energy, you know, the power of the Spirit was on you. And you felt like you could just keep going and just keep doing it. And I felt we were pressing through on something. And I know we were. There was a breakthrough on that. Look at this. The place of agreement is among the brethren. The power of agreement is in the anointing. The purpose of agreement is to extend the kingdom of God. Here on earth, and of course in heaven it is. And the product of agreement is the refreshing. The product of agreement is a release of revival. Have you noticed that the last 2 years, COVID years, everything about this has been focused on division? And we have a prime minister and leaders who are actually actively dividing people, divisive by their own communication. Very sad, actually. But division on every level. Churches have gone through it. Ministries have gone through it. Businesses have gone through it. Families have gone through it. We did a funeral not long ago where the funeral, the people who were on one side of the whole masking, vaccine issue, and then there were people that were on the opposite side, and both wouldn't come together at the funeral because, you know. Yeah, that's what I said. Wow. Wow, I can't believe people can be that stupid. That's what I thought, too. I thought, we got to get up. We got to get bigger than that. We got to rise above that. That's ridiculous. We can't play into the tools of the enemy. That's what we have to recognize. We stay together in rank for the kingdom of God. We only have so much time on this earth. Believe me, and this is the time where you can gain rewards. This is it. When you're in heaven, you can say, oh, I'll pray 24 hours a day now, Lord. No, you're in heaven. There is no 24 hours a day anymore. How many understand what I'm saying? I'm saying the time to do what God has called you to do is now. Yes. Not tomorrow, not in heaven. You know, I've heard, oh, I'll serve Jesus when I get to heaven. No, you won't. If you serve him here, you will. But you know what? You've got to serve him in the now and the present. Yes. Give him all you've got. Look at this quote by Henry Ford. You all know who Henry Ford is. Some will say he made the finest vehicles. This side of the room said, the finest vehicles ever over these. These people are, we're going to, they're terrible. Fix or repair daily. I was shocked one time. I brought up something like that, a Ford, and then there was a GMC guys over here, and next thing you know, they're all in disagreement. Whoa, who knew, right? I'm sorry, I should have read the quote. Coming together is the beginning. Staying together is progress. Working together is success. Amen. Beloved, how many can make it to that third stage? How many can make it to the third stage? I'll tell you what, we got a lot of armchair critics, but how many can make it to the third stage? Working together. Working together because there's a bigger cause. We start looking at each other and poking at each other. We're not working together then. We're not looking at the bigger cause. And that's where we're at. We have a harvest in front of us in this nation. We are in a pivotal moment. I want something to share with you that we've been working on over these past months. Actually, quite a few months. Started over a year ago. We were... Joan and I, our history begins with the church on the highway. It was known as Victory Church. It's not a Victory Church today. It's called a different name. We started our ministry there, and we came in 1981. By 1982, I was a deacon, so I was Deacon Dick here, Deacon Dick there. And I did serve, and then I was an elder by 1983, and then I was on full-time staff as the associate pastor. Shortly after that, I became the senior pastor. George and Hazel Hill were the founders, and they were tremendous, gifted apostolic leaders. One day they came to me in 1987, and they said, George came to me, and we had coffee. He said, well, let's have coffee. And so he said, you know, you have the call of a senior pastor on you, and I have the call of a senior pastor on me. I said, yeah, I guess so, yes, I think so. And he said, well, you can't have two in the same church. So he says, you know, one of us is to go, and so I'm sending you to Medicine Hat to plant a church. And I said, okay. I said, all right, okay. I was thinking to myself, how's Joan going to like this? But anyway, I said, okay, yeah, I can understand that. And I was fine. I was up with a challenge. What I did tell him is that for a year, the Lord had told me that I would take over the church there from him. No, just as a successor, you know. I didn't tell him that. And I had five people come to me in that period of time and tell me, the Lord has shown me that you're going to pastor this church. And I told them, every one of them, all five, I said, don't you ever say that. Don't ever share it with anybody. Keep it to yourself. Don't ever talk about it. If you want to pray about it, that's your business, but don't say anything. And so he comes to me and says, I'm going to Mesonata. I said, okay. So I went down. I started preparing the way. I got a building. I got everything ready. We were just a weeks away from launching. It was actually going to be, we had a fairly good facility, actually, that we found. It was one that they eventually purchased. And it was a former church, and it was really a good location. Everything was ready. 2 weeks before, he calls me, and he says, you know, I have to have coffee with you. And so, okay, we have coffee, and as we're having coffee, we're chatting about something, and all of a sudden, he just stops, and he says, listen, I've got to tell you what the Lord has told me. I'm listening, yes? He says, you're supposed to stay, I'm supposed to go to Medicine Hat. God has called me to launch a network of churches, and I need to go. And I thought, is this a trick? I thought, what's going on here? And so I just kind of left it, and we talked a little more. Are you sure, you know? And then finally I told him what the Lord had put in my heart. There's a point I'm telling you this, is that when I stepped in as the leader there, I stepped in because God released it to me, because it was put in the heart of the senior leader founders. And then we worked together with them to launch what was known as Victory Churches of Canada. Today, there are no churches like this of victory churches in the city. But at the time, there were several, and we were part of that. We not only planted a new church out of that, but we planted about 9 or 10 churches in other regions. I had a phone conversation the other day with one of the gentlemen, and it's in Swift Current, and we just had a real pleasant time of connecting because we went out to plant that, and it's become a very successful church, and there are a number of others. And so, let's move forward. We had a very good relationship with that. We then went to the Miracle Channel. I did tell this story that in 1996, the Lord spoke to me to release, when we raised the finances to pay off the mortgage on the property on the highway, the Lord spoke to me and said, release this church and take the Miracle Channel and take it across the nation. And Joan and I obeyed that word. I'm very sacrificial. 4 years of very, very hard, I'm just plowing kinds of work. And so when we did that, we also had a church. We called it Dominion Gateway. It was also part of the Victory Churches. Moving forward, you know that we opened the airwaves. We did all these things. We expanded that. It became a very large ministry. Huge amount of income. In 2007, because of personal failure, I exited the ministry. And for a period of time, I was in secular work, and it didn't belong to any. We attended the church there, but we weren't connected in leadership in any form. And then in 2009, it just became very obvious to us that we just didn't fit anywhere in a church. And so we asked the Hills at that time and the pastor over at the highway if we could be released because we didn't know where to go. We didn't know where to go. We didn't fit anywhere. Here's the problem. When something like what happened to me, a moral failure, and you stay in the same city, it's almost impossible to integrate into the body of Christ because it was of such a large nature. Now, it's history now, and it's not quite the same. I know that. But back then, it was. And it was very hard for us to get back into any fellowship or any church. And so we ended up getting a release in November of 2009. And I'm going to be honest with you, for a number of months, we didn't go anywhere. There just was nowhere to go. And finally, my son and daughter-in-law, Matt and Nadine Deweert, said to us, they said, Dad and Mom, why don't you just come with us and attend a church with us? I said, okay. And so we did. And that's how we ended up somewhere else. During that couple-year period, the Lord began to deal with me and called me to start Third Day Church. And you've heard that story. I went to everybody in the city. I got the release. I got the blessing from everybody I could before we launched this. And January was our 10th anniversary. This past January, 10 is the number of testing. 10 is the number of proving. 10 is where you walk into a threshold of a new destiny. And so, having moved forward in that, about 2 years ago, not a year and a half ago, you may recall that the church on the highway that was known as the Victory Church left the organization. And I don't want to say anything about that, except that that really grieved Joan and I, because we know that a movement of hundreds and hundreds of churches and missions and ministries like the Miracle Channel were birthed out of that mother church. And this grieved us. And then one day we just get this letter. We hadn't been in communication for years with hardly anyone in the organization, but some a little bit, but not a lot. And we get this email about this event that's going on. And Joan, when soon as she reads this, she goes into intercession for 4 hours. Now, Joan said to me, she said, I've not interceded like that since I've had cancer in 2013. That something inside of me was locked up, but suddenly I began to groan and travail, and something was moving, or something in the spirit. And I was very grieved, and I called them right away, and we went and spent 3 days with the Hills in Calgary. And we just weren't there to choose sides. We were just there to support them. We knew the feeling. We knew how it was to be severed from a ministry. And so we just understood that. And we went and spent time with them and encouraged them. And something was healed in our relationship. And some of you might remember, they came here to a church service. I think it was in September. of 2020, right? And they sat right there, and they didn't tell me they were coming. They came, and it was a real blessing. So let me move forward. For a long time, the Holy Spirit had been working on my heart and saying to me that we needed to connect, that we needed to connect with a greater group of churches, that we needed to restore our relationship that we have. We're part of the foundation of that whole movement. And by the way, it was in January, I was on this Zoom call, or Zoom conference with Al Purvis, Al and Terry Purvis, and their daughter Becky Watson, and it went into 2,000 leaders through India, Pakistan, Burma, Malaysia, Singapore, Thailand, Cambodia, Vietnam, I mean, Sri Lanka. There was all these regions, all these Bible schools and church planning churches that were part of this conference, and I was one of the keynote speakers along with Wayne Boersma, who was the previous one in the previous day. It was a two-day event. And something really touched me about this, that it was a healthy church planting movement. I saw young people rising up and then being released and planting churches and moving forward. And I thought, you know, this is what it takes. This is what it takes to take a nation. You see, what we got to understand is the building block of God is the local church. No, he doesn't just use YouTube. That's just a delivery system. The building block of the kingdom of God is the local church, where people gather together, shoulder to shoulder, pray together, work together to lead and to open the kingdom of God. So I was really touched with that. And so about, months ago, it's many months ago, Joan said to me one day in our living room or in our kitchen, she said, "Have you ever thought about joining Victory Churches?" And I said to her, "Well, actually, I've been thinking about it for a year." I was honest. I said, "I've really been thinking about it, and I just had never made a move on it." And so I thought, you know something? God has really been dealing with me, that we need to connect to a larger group of churches for the longevity of this church. See, what would happen if, for some reason or another, God forbid, I was incapacitated? I said the wrong thing to Joan, she gave me a punch, and I'm out. No, that doesn't happen. She's upset now because I'm vilifying her, you know. But I'm just trying to be humorous. What if I were incapacitated? What if I couldn't lead? There needs to be a covering organization that helps us as a church. But here's the other thing. With alone we can do so much, but together we can do so more, much more. Amen. One shall cause 1,000 to flee, but two shall cause 10,000 to flee. There's this it multiplies. There's this principle of multiplication when you work together. So moving forward, Paul Just came. We connected with Paul Just, who I had raised up in ministry when we were on the highway. And Paul Just, we went out to Grand Prairie. Now, Paul had gone to missions in Mexico, then to Africa. I had actually gone out to Africa and spent a few weeks with him at the Bible College there and preaching in Africa and Kenya. And that was in the early 90s I went there. And so Paul, you see him on your screen, he'll be here this coming Sunday. Paul came, we connected with Paul up in Grand Prairie when they did the Alberta Linked. And it's like we spent 30 seconds together and our relationship was healed. And we felt so close and he honored us. And so we began to communicate with Paul. And then later we had Paul come in and do television for us and he spoke at Tefillah. But our time together with him was so rich, and it was so healing, and it really confirmed something in my heart, that God wanted us to connect once again with many of the folks that we have the same spiritual DNA. And so I contacted, through Paul, this is how it started, I contacted Victory Churches of Canada, found out a little more of the structure. They're based in their head offices in Calgary. They have hundreds of churches worldwide. Hundreds in Canada, but many, many more worldwide. They are functioning differently. George and Hazel are the leaders emeritus. They are kind of the figurehead, the presidents and founders, but the individual nations operate with their own boards, if you will. And so we started to communicate. We had some Zoom calls, and the more I shared, the more excited everyone became. And I saw in one of our board meetings, I shared this, and I saw this vision. I'll tell you how it went. I shared this, and our board was unanimous. They said, we need to move this way. This is what we need to do as a church. So as we were closing the board meeting, I said, let's pray as we close. And then I said, Joan, close the board meeting with prayer. And I don't even know why I did this. I just was very spontaneous. And so she looked at me like, okay, you know. And she closed the board meeting. And as she's praying, the Lord gave me a vision. And the vision that I saw was like that, what you see on your screen right now. A massive tree. This massive tree. And in the tree, I saw that all these branches were these churches that have come out of the soil of this city, the mother church. Now, part of the branches were the Miracle Channel. Some of them were other churches that I planted. All of these branches, and it was producing fruit. And then I saw this huge trunk, but in the trunk was no longer connected to the soil that birthed it. That there was no longer roots into this soil. And what the Lord showed me is that this soil produced revival. This region. Now, I'm going to go back again nearly 40 years. We were in revival. It was common to see demons coming out of people in every service. It was common to see people being healed, slain in the spirit, and being delivered. It was common to have altar calls where people would come up and you'd say, okay, if you're addicted to cigarettes, you know, and they'd come up, and then you'd see all these people up front, and they'd say, okay, take your cigarettes and throw them down on the ground, and they did, and then now stomp on them, and they'd all stomp on them, you know. Some of you might have seen this. There were things like that. There were other addictions and things that people were delivered of. That root of revival produced a movement. And I feel the Holy Spirit has said to me that we can connect that tree to the root of revival. Amen. Through this ministry. Because you know why? We were there from the beginning. We were there from the root. That's what spawned our lives. We somehow evolved and migrated out. We never did it in a wrong spirit. We never did it in rebellion. We made sure we had a release. We had everything. We had the blessing in everything that we did. When we started this church, we went to everybody and asked them for their blessing as we planted this church. You know why I did that? I believe in the spirit of honor. I believe in the spirit of submission. I believe that when you honor those over you and when you honor brethren, and that you do things in the right spirit, God will bless you. And I tell you, He did. When the Lord spoke to me in 1996, October, He came and said to me, after I'd preached the morning service on the highway, church on the highway, He said to me, in that service, I raised the last $40,000 to pay off the mortgage. It was a multi-million dollar mortgage on that property, and we paid it off that time. It was October 1996. As I got in my car, I was driving across the parking lot. The Holy Spirit said to me, release this church, take the Miracle Channel, and take it across the nation. And I said, Lord, that's not fair. I just paid this off. I think we're just going to have a little bit of money right now. It's just been nothing but hardship up to this point, and we barely made it. Now you're telling me to just leave it and take the Miracle Channel. He said, then this is what he said. He said, if you obey me, I will send men to you who will give you millions of dollars. 4 years later, 3.5 years later, that was literally fulfilled in a Tim Hortons in Burlington, Ontario. In a Tim Hortons. A man gave us a check for $1 million, and it was good. We took it into the bank, and the bank said, yeah, sure, okay, yeah, we'll check that out. And then came back and said, this is good. This is really good. God fulfilled His word. Amen. And you know why? When you work in networks, when you work in honor, when you work in respect, when you work with submission, when you work with blessing, God will bring His best upon you. And we are moving in the days of revival, folks. You just felt it in this service this morning. There's a move of the Holy Spirit coming, and we need all hands on deck. And I believe that God is saying to us that we need to connect once again with these hundreds of churches so that we can maintain and fill the harvest. And so we've already signed a letter of intent to walk together to begin the process of rejoining the organization. And we feel that this has been something that God has truly led us in doing. And now you know why I've been talking about repairing the breach. You see, we Christians have to figure it out. We split up all the time. I don't like the way you do this or do that. We've got to figure it out. We need to work together. And you know what? Let me just say something. We're not called to work together with everybody. Do you know that there were 12 tribes in Israel? But they were one, right? Was Israel one? Yes, it was. Was Israel their nation under God? But there were 12 tribes. And so, you know, there was a distinct purpose for each one of those tribes. In fact, to possess the land they had to break it up to the 12 tribes. But they were still one. And we've got to understand the body of Christ that way. There are tribes, but we are one. And I'm thankful for every tribe. I'm thankful for every church. I truly am. I'm sad when I hear of a church shutting down. And that, you know what? In this city, I've heard of a number of churches that haven't made it through the COVID shutdown. They're on the verge of shutting down. But I will tell you this, that, and I'm never happy about this, but it does tell us that we need to pull together and work in this hour, in this day, for the kingdom of God. And I want to tell you something else. And I know you trust me as your leader. I sense the hand of God on this. I know that God has put his hand on us for this purpose. I've even felt his blessing as we've done it and as we've moved in this direction. It gives us access to many, many, many leaders. It gives us a place to release many leaders. It gives us access to bring in ministry when we need it. But in the event if I were not here, it would give us safety because someone would be able to carry it forward. How many can understand that? Amen. So together, I want to put this up. I'd like to put this. This is the last inscription from a church in England. They'll get it up for you. This inscription on a church in England in the year 1653, when all things sacred in the kingdom were either profaned or demolished, this church was built to do the best of things in the worst of times. I think that is today. How many would agree with me? Amen. That is a statement about today. The church is under assault. Listen, 52 churches were burned in 2020 when all of the, you know, I don't want to get into the issue, but it was horrific. And 52 churches, and the prime minister said nothing. Said nothing. 52 churches torched. And you know what they said? The police said, I got this from the premier of this province. The police said none of them were burned by First Nations. Think of this. How horrific this is. Says nothing. The premier, I had a personal conversation with our premier last summer, actually. And he said to me, I did call the prime minister and said, why haven't you said something about this? If it had been a mosque, it would have been in the news for 40 days. What he was just pointing out, and I'm just telling you what the premier was pointing out, is that there is a skewed view on the church. The devil wants to destroy the house of God in this hour, and he's using anybody and anyone he can to do it. But we need to pull together. We need to circle the wagon and say, no, we're the body of Christ. So when you hear of another church in town in stress or something, you pray for them. Yes. You bless them. Amen. Tell them. You don't want that church to fail. Oh, well, they don't think like us. Well, that's fine. A lot of people don't think like you. Just, they are the body of Christ, and we need to bless them. And I want you to be clear about my spirit on this. I'm not divisive at any time. I believe in the unity of the body of Christ. And I also believe in blessing others in the body of Christ. And so today, I wanted to share this with you that we are moving in this direction. I believe we are repairing a breach. I believe that we are restoring. something that was birthed in this region. And I want to emphasize again, how many were there? There might be people here that were there in the early 80s and 1980s. Oh, look at all the hands. They're witnesses. There were, in 1991, Joan and I and our team counted up the number of people we had in the church at that time. We came up with 1,190 regular attenders. If they weren't regular, they weren't on our list. 1,190 that was attending at that time. People had been coming to the Lord, getting saved, being discipled. And we had a Bible college. We were planting, I planted 11 churches out of that church alone, and then the Miracle Channel as well. Something great came out of that movement. Whereas there was such a root of revival in that. And I believe that God is bringing all the streams of the body of Christ together in these last days. That's what I believe. The harvest is so great, he can't just be one here, one there. He's bringing us together to win the harvest. Amen. Can you see with me lines, people lined up down the block, waiting to come in because they want to get healed? Amen. Can you see it? Because I can. You don't understand the atmosphere when revival comes. Just like the Welsh revival. It was horrid before revival. Just before revival comes, it's as horrible, as bad as it can be, and then the atmosphere changes. So let me tell you another little secret. I've got my eye on the property next to us. Say, well, how are you going to do that? I don't know, by faith. But I see the day when we need it. I see the day when the kingdom is advancing, and we will need it. And by the way, it's all one property here, so we have the arrangement we have. We lease this with, we have a condition or a clause of purchase. We can purchase this at any time, this 20,000 square feet. When God gives us a miracle, we're going to get a miracle. Amen. The Lord spoke to me and said, we're going to get our miracle. We're going to purchase this. But then I think we're going to move into securing that as well, because I see that. I see revival. I see the Spirit. Listen, it looks bad out there, but I'm going to tell you what. God is on the throne. He says, I want a harvest. I want a harvest. I want to fill heaven, plunder hell. I want to see people come to the Lord. Let's not be discouraged in the age that we're in, but let's believe for the mercies of God. See, it's mercy. When God sends revival, it's mercy. It's going to save us. And we have seen this in our spirit, Joan, for years and years, have we not? We have seen it. We've had that promise given to us, and I am not letting go. And I like this quote I gave about the Welsh revival, and I thought, how true that is for us today. The nation looks at its lowest point, and then revival came. Amen. And the Welsh revival transformed the entire nation. Pubs changed. They all were singing hymns in the pubs. Think of that. Alcoholism just almost eradicated. All of these side effects of negativity just eradicated in Wales. I would like to encourage you, read some books on revival. Read books about historic revivals. The Isle of Lewis and in the Isle of Skye, there was the great revival that took place in the late 40s under leadership of a man named Duncan Campbell. He talks about how those regions in Scotland became so transformed that people would come off the ferry from mainland Scotland, step onto the island dock of the Isle of Lewis, and fall on their knees on the dock and say, I need God. Something so transformed in the atmosphere and even on the soil of this island experiencing revival. Churches filled as people coming to the Lord. The atmosphere so changed that people couldn't even step on the dock and not experience the presence of God. Beloved, 5 times in the Bible, the Lord says this, as surely as I live, all the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. When God says, as surely as I live, as surely as I live. Are you hearing what he said? As surely as I live. What he's saying is, before we leave this planet, the whole earth will be filled with the knowledge of his glory. We are on the cusp of the greatest move of Holy Spirit, unprecedented, and we need to be prepared. We need to get all our nets in order. We need to expand all that we're doing because the harvest is coming in. Amen? And we need to work together to win as many as we can to Christ in this hour, because they're going to come. Are you ready to disciple a few folks? Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's hope you can. You might have to take them home and feed them dinner and minister to them and teach them the Bible. But disciple them, right, Bob? Bob will love that. We will let Bob preach and teach endlessly to disciple all the new believers. And he'll just be grinning ear to ear. I just see his grin right now. Thank you, Lord. Let's stand. Worship team, if you would come. Lord, we thank... Joan wants to share something. Just be seated just a minute.
I just want to share a little bit of what I shared yesterday, but I feel it's worth repeating again today. Because I wanted to share about this day that we received an email about what was happening with the root of the mother church of this organization, and how instantly I was in travail. And I travailed for at least 4.5 to 5 hours that day. I left home weeping, came to the office and was in the staff meeting that morning. It was a Tuesday morning, just weeping and travailing and groaning. And I kept saying, God, why? What's going on? I don't understand this. And so that day passed, and, you know, Dick and I just, we really didn't ever understand what that travail was all about. But as we've progressed in this year, at the beginning of this year, the Lord said to Dick and me, he said, prepare, 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 because the revival is coming. I didn't understand. We did what we could. We did what we knew to do. But then the Lord started speaking to us about this, about repairing the breach and connecting, reconnecting to the root of revival that is in this city. And all of a sudden, I said to Dick one day, I know now what that travail was about. I believe that in some way, I travailed and I birthed what is happening today in the Spirit. And I feel it on me again today. There's something so powerful happening. I just really believe that this is the heart of God. And I really believe that God is into reversal and restoration. And I had that word at the last Dominion Conference at the last night. The word of the Lord was that 2022 would be a year of reversal and restoration. When I shared that with Pastor George Hill, he said, that's an interesting word, reversal. I said, I know. I don't know why, but it just came out of my spirit. Reversal and restoration. I believe that that word is much bigger than what we're seeing here, because there's going to be much more reversal and restoration in the Spirit. God is bigger than one church. There's things that God is going to do. And I am a person who loves restoration. I hate it when the body of Christ is ripped apart. I'm believing for reversal and restoration in many ways in this city, because this city has been singled out by God years and years ago for him to visit. He said, I will visit this city and the surrounding area of 100-mile radius. And he said, what I do here, the nation and the nations will see. And that's why we believe that Christian television was so important. And of course, media is so much bigger now, live stream, and there's so much more to it. But at that point, Christian television was it. If you were on TV, you could get seen across the nation. The internet wasn't quite there yet. But anyway, just want to say this. that Ann Fielding texted me a couple of days ago, and she forwarded some points of interest that, prophetic points that Cindy Jacobs had released when she had her global council of prophetic elders together, and they released the word of the Lord for 2022. The very first thing that they did release was this. The scripture, new wine, is found in the cluster from Isaiah 65, verse 8, was key for this year. And I know that what we're doing is we're entering into, and we are in the middle of a spiritual battle. That, you know, the word says we don't battle against flesh and blood, but our battle is against principalities and against powers and against the rulers of the darkness of this age and against spiritual hosts of wickedness in high places. And I said yesterday, I'm going to say it again, during these 2 years, there has been a principality and maybe principalities over areas, over regions, over nations that have come, and their assignment has been to divide and conquer, to divide the body of Christ. And it's been unbelievable what has happened. But God says, I am going to reverse and I am going to restore, says the Lord. And here's what they said. Teamwork will release the dream work that will reveal visions on how to proceed into the future. And I really believe that we're just on the cusp of something. But God is going to lead us and God is going to take us. Third thing they said here is redigging of the wells of revival. Places that once saw great moves of God will experience His visitation again. And then she's put in brackets there, I believe this is Lethbridge and the surrounding area. Strongholds that only corporate worship will break. Worship is a major key to the awakenings. And you know what? I remember in the early days of when we, and that root and the things that were coming out of that root, the movement that it birthed, there was worship, but there was also high praises. And we knew that when we were in high praises and worship together, that strongholds were being broken and the enemy's power was being broken and defeated. I believe that we're going to see that again. And I know that the enemy's tried to pull it apart, but I believe, and I just declare today, reversal and restoration. Because God's people are going to come together and we're going to have high praises. And this is a restoration of the revival that used to be, that was. There's something that God is going to do that only the body of Christ coming together. You know, we can't negotiate with the enemy. We have to go higher, right? And so much of our warfare is done in worship. Praise and worship, and many other things were released that we're walking through right now. So I just wanted to encourage you with that. I really believe that the hand of God is on this, and even as we've made this steps towards this reconnecting, we feel a surge of a new power and a new release. It's on us. And it's going to only increase in the days that come. I just really believe God is up to something really big. He's up to something really good.
Let's just stand and join hands right now. We're going to just commit this, what I shared, Joan just shared. We're going to commit it to the Lord, and then we're going to... By the way, we got some great news. There's pie and coffee in the lobby afterwards. And you haven't done this for over 2 years, so you cannot miss this, obviously. You can take the pie home too. But let's join our hands and pray. Lord, we come to you because the word of God says if two should agree. You love agreement, Lord. You love agreement. You love it when we walk in agreement for your purpose, for you. When we're under your authority, you love it when we agree with one another to advance your kingdom. Lord, all the vision that we've shared today, all of the details, we lift up to you as a people of God, as a family. And we submit them to you. We surrender them to you for your blessing. Lord, we thank you for your goodness and mercy coming upon us. We know, Lord, that one shall cause 1,000, but two shall cause 10,000 to flee. We, oh God, thank you for agreement today. We thank you for agreement in your kingdom. We bless the body of Christ, as diverse as it is in this city and beyond. And we release your favor on all of them in Jesus' name. We're not against anybody, but we are for you, Lord. We are for you. We want to see all of your people prosper in your kingdom, and we seek your blessing in this hour in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing that song, Remember. Remember, we're going to remember.
Remember how our God has never failed, never failed us. Remember that his name will make a way, he'll make a way. From the cross to the grave, he is risen and he reigns. Praise the Lord, sing his praise again.
This week. Have an awesome day, week ahead. In Jesus' name.